out in the shop today doing a little bit of work on building up an antenna relay for the notorious Collins 20V transmitter, which is sitting right over there waiting for a relay to be installed so that we can switch between transmit and receive. And I've got several relays that would work, but I don't think that they would handle the power, so I've come up with this kind of an arrangement. It's mounted on a ceramic standoff, and it's got some pretty hefty contacts on it, so I'm thinking that I'll actually double up the contacts because they're the same on both sides, and mount that into the box and wire up some SL239 connectors and see what we end up with. The relay is activated with 6 volts DC, and that'll be easy to come up with. And the plan of attack is to use a little transformer right there, which has a 220 volt primary, a 110 secondary, and a 6.3 volt AC secondary as well. So I'm going to use a bridge rectifier and a filter capacitor and kind of wire this all up and just see what we come up with. Continue along, I've got two UHF connector, female connectors mounted. One end and one on the other end. So we're all set to get ready and mount the relay in the box, which will be down on one end here. Oops. One of the reasons I decided to use this relay, it kind of unique construction. It's kind of slick. If you watch it very, very carefully, I don't know if you can see it or not, but as the relay closes, the contacts have a tendency to wipe. In other words, it's a hit, push down, and it wipes a little bit. When it comes back up, it hits and wipes a little bit. I don't know if you could see that or not, but pretty slick. Maybe other relays do it, but that's the first time I've ever noticed something like that. Anyway, we're going to mount this between these two connectors so that the connection between them will be very, very short. And one will be the antenna input, the other will be the transmitter, and the one on the forehand, of course, will be the receiver. The feed-through fittings, they're double-aught ones. That should be sufficient. If not, I can hang something internally. But I'll bring 6 volts AC in, very low impedance, so I shouldn't have too much trouble with that. And I'll build a little bridge rectifier and filter capacitor to supply the relay coil to activate it. And then we should be ready to go. The mechanical stuff's pretty much there, so all we have to do now is start wiring. Everything pretty well wired up except for the activator coil. And I've got my meter on here, and we're looking at the continuity between the antenna input, which is the red, and the transmitter, which is the black. And the meter right here, and I'm going to reach down and just push the relay in, and I do have continuity. Okay, so that part of it's working pretty good. Going over to the receive port, I should have continuity between the receive port, and I should have continuity between the antenna port, and I do. There we go. And there's the continuous feed to the receiver. And when I press the relay down to activate the transmitter, the receiver disconnects. And it also does one more thing. If I stay on the receiver line right here and go to ground, and I activate the transmitter, I see a grounded receiver port. So just to make sure there's no RF or very little RF couple down the receiver coax to the receiver, it just gets a dead short while the transmitter is operational. So next thing to do now is to actually hook up a transmitter to it and see how much VSWR this thing generates at the operating frequency. This works. Well, what I've got here is a transceiver. I've got it set on AM, so it should be less than 50 watts. And I've got a 50 watt slug, and I'm arranging it so that it's going to measure forward power through the box and out the antenna port. So this would be the port that the big transmitter would be hooked to, and that would be the antenna port right up there. And putting a little power on, let's close the relay, and I should be able to key up, and I should see, yes I do, I should see about 30 watts of AM. Okay, before I get carried away, let's turn the slug around, and I should see nothing, if it's working like I hope it's working. Key, unkey, key. You can almost see the needle wiggle a little bit, but not much. And the idea here is that we don't want any VSWR or reflective power to end up being caused by the box. Anyway, I'm going to button it up here in a little bit, and we'll be ready to run some actual tests with the big transmitter. I still have to wire up the keying transformer and diode rectifier and capacitor, which I'll put in the box, but I think this is going to work out pretty well. Just about there. This is the transformer that's going to be mounted in the transmitter, and a pigtail running out there will run to the 220 volts through a couple of fuses. And I've just got a little inverter here just in case, so I can set the limit with the power supply. So if I turn on the power supply, as soon as I turn on 12 volts, I'm going to get 110 volts out of the inverter, current limited, and the 110 volts will go into this transformer, and the secondary tap that I have hooked up is 6.3 volts AC. 6.3 volts AC will go to the bridge rectifier inside the box with a filter capacitor, and it should pull in the relay. And we'll turn the power on here and see what happens. Alright, I'm going to just go ahead and turn the power on. And looks pretty good. That delay that you're perceiving is the inverter coming on. As soon as the ready light comes on, bang, it engages. So, gave me a little bit of a start there for a second. And there's just a tiny bit of delay when it drops. And bang, yeah. Yep, I think we're there. I'll go ahead and put a cover on this puppy and wire up to this thing to the big transmitter.